FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz. Today is February 27th, 2017. John, good morning. So lots of great things going on, but if you looked at the headlines, you would think very little is happening other than a blunder at the wonderful Academy Awards, right?
Morning, Kerry. Yeah, that had to hurt.
And it couldn't happen to nicer, lesser educated people, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, you can get a lot of things wrong at the Oscars, but the Best Picture Award, that's the thing you don't want to mess up. And that's the thing they did mess up. So somebody is in big trouble there because somebody gave the wrong envelope to the people who were supposed to read it. And I don't think we'll ever find out who it is. And you know what? That shouldn't be made public. The poor, you know, think how bad that guy feels right now. And
I think it was the Russians, John. I really believe it was the Russians. They hacked the Academy Awards. and this is what you get, right?
Yeah. Treason. Yeah. Oh, God. Well, in general, like you said, this should be a really eventful time from our point of view, you know, finance and economics and stuff. But nothing was really happening out there in the markets. Everything is kind of frozen in place. You know, stocks are at all-time high, but they're just sitting there. And gold is up lately, but not rocketing, you know, not really bouncing around all that much. And same thing with bonds. So you've kind of got the risk-on trade and the risk-off trade in balance. In other words, money's flowing into pretty much everything. You know, nothing is plunging, nothing is rocketing either, but everything is pretty firm. And I think the reason for that is that nobody knows what's going to happen next. You know, we might have this gigantic crisis, which we should based on all the numbers, you know, the amount of debt that's been taken on, et cetera, you know, and what you and I have been talking about all this time. But you've got Trump getting ready to announce a budget, and there's speculation that this is going to include big tax cuts and deregulation and increased spending on some things that Wall Street likes. So money managers aren't sure whether that's a good enough thing to offset the horrible debt numbers that are out there, you know, the amount of leverage that's in the system that is terrifyingly high. So everybody's kind of frozen in place. Now, this kind of a dam will break one way or the other, because it has to eventually. And my guess is that eventually it breaks to the risk-off side, that it becomes obvious to everybody that no matter what you've got coming out of Washington right now, stocks can't really go up much from here when they're above levels at which previous crashes occurred. There was a stat that Zero Hedge published a while ago about the amount of time the average American has to work to buy the average stock.
Right.
And, you know, that's a measure of stock prices in relation to the earnings of the average person. And it's now at levels that are higher than 2000 or than 1999, which is the all-time high in the past. And every time it's been anywhere near this number, stocks have crashed because they've gotten too expensive for people to buy. And so people stop buying them.
Right.
So I think there's a good chance that this happens again in the not too distant future, just because when things get this expensive, they have to turn around. Now, the counter argument to that is that, well, if Trump cuts corporate taxes, that means corporate earnings are going to go up. And if central banks start buying equities, which some of them are, and some of the other ones are going to start pretty soon, that'll push up equities. And so maybe we're in this brave new world of public money flowing into private asset markets and just elevating them forever. That would be a catastrophe.
Is Lutz today
prices to currencies, then we'd finally get that dollar collapse that you've got coming out of Washington been talking about for a decade now. But I think that is the way it'll go, that eventually the fiat currencies of the world become the epicenter of the serious global crisis that finally takes down the system in its current form. When that'll be is anybody's guess. This has just gone on for such a long time that it's become obvious that you can't predict timing with any kind of certainty, because governments are doing so many unprecedented things with basically unlimited amounts of money. You know, you put a printing press in the hands of a central bank, and by implication in the hands of, you know, elected officials and their appointed bureaucrats, and obviously they're going to abuse that power. But lately they've been abusing it in ways that's just astounding, you know, really unprecedented, pushing interest rates down to negative territory. And in the case of the Japanese National Bank and the Swiss National Bank, buying equities really aggressively. You know, the Swiss Bank and the Japanese Bank are essentially gigantic hedge funds now. You know, they're leading the risk on trade and leveraging themselves to the hilt to buy risky assets with basically taxpayer money. There's a lot of speculation that the U.S. Fed and the European Central Bank will be forced to do the same thing in the next bear market because they won't have anything else they can do. They've already bought up all the bonds. They've already pushed interest rates down to, in some cases, below zero. You know, the German two-year bond now is yielding something like negative 0.6%. So you buy that and hold it, and your capital shrinks year after year after year. Which means the global economy shrinks year after year after year. We're on a negative interest rate regime. So this stuff is unsustainable. But since they've been able to sustain it for a surprisingly long time, it's hard to know when they lose the ability to sustain it. But I do think that a currency crisis is out there. When people finally realize that the things governments are doing to elevate asset prices require them to create so much new currency that the currency itself isn't trustworthy anymore, and people start bailing on it, and then you get a crisis in which nobody wants to hold the currency, which causes interest rates to spike because governments have to borrow a lot of money at higher and higher rates because nobody wants to buy the bonds, and you know, it just goes on like that. Currencies crash, interest rates spike, the system breaks down. That's out there somewhere, and you don't want to be on the wrong side of that when it happens, but there's no way to know when it happens, so you don't know how to make the transition. Should you do it all at once? Should you completely get out of government bonds and into real assets today? Or should you do it a little at a time over the next 5 years? And that's the big intellectual challenge, because it's impossible to say with any kind of certainty which strategy in terms of timing is the right one. You know, it's eventually going to be the right one, but do you do it all at once, or do you do it a little at a time? And I don't have an answer for that. You know, I'm doing it over time, but emotionally I want to do it all at once. I want to just get it over with, completely bail on stocks and completely load up on gold and silver and then just sit. But I don't know whether now is the right time to do that or not. It might be, but it might not be.
Yeah, well, timing is always a bitch, as they say, but everything in life is timing, and that's the thing. I find it's kind of like I have a really bad sense of direction, so if I'm trying to figure out whether to go right or left, the first thing I look for is cues. So, like, for instance, if I'm in a town, like older towns, so, and it's by the water, then I know that the town developed from the water, probably where I'm looking for. If it's in the main part of town, it's probably going to be by the water. So you look for cues. And so what cues can we look for, John? Because these things don't happen in a vacuum. There's usually warning. It doesn't just happen, just like these crashes when they occurred. I mean, in 2008, 2007, you saw what was happening with real estate, and the really smart people were actually able to place bets on it. But even the people who weren't that smart sold their houses and got into cash and got into other things that enabled them to ride out the storm and actually turn a profit on it. So what are the cues here, John?
Well, that's the thing, Kerry. The government, by creating all this new currency and buying assets almost indiscriminately, is short-circuiting the signals that used to be meaningful. For instance, margin debt. You know, that's people borrowing against stocks to buy more stocks. Usually when it hits a certain level, a crash occurs because people have basically just borrowed all they can borrow to buy all the stocks they can buy, and there's nobody left to buy, so stocks go down. Well, we've been at that level, you know, the level that usually presages a crash, since 2014, and it's gone up since it hit that level in 2014. And so that signal doesn't mean anything right now. You know, it means that eventually there will be a crash, but it doesn't mean anything in terms of timing. And you can look at all the major timing signals of past stock markets, the things that told us when it was time to bail, and they've all hit the time to bail level and kept on going. So it's not clear what we can look at to let us know that now is the time to get out of stocks and into real assets or into cash or whatever. But I also think that just because something is way out of whack doesn't mean it can be way out of whack forever. You know, unsustainable means that eventually it ends. And what's happening now is completely unsustainable. So it's possible that we'll see sectors of the economy roll over and turn into mini crises. And that we'll have the government saying, oh, it's well contained, like they said with subprime mortgages in 2007. And they'll be wrong. And then those things will, at least in retrospect, be the signals that we should have heeded. You know, the car industry in the U.S., for instance, has been just firing on all cylinders for the last few years. You know, the car sales are at record levels, and the number of car loans being taken out is at a record level, and the amount of money that's being lent to subprime borrowers in that sector is at a record level. And now it's starting to roll over. Car sales are plateauing, and subprime auto loans are starting to go bad at an accelerating rate. So that's the kind of thing that we might look at in retrospect with a couple of years of hindsight and say, oh, yeah, we should have paid attention when that happened. But right now, it's not obvious that that is a signal of broader trouble in the global financial system. But if two or three things like that happen, for instance, an Italian banking crisis coupled with the collapse of the subprime auto lending market in the U.S. and maybe some student loan default spikes, you know, put all that together, and then you've got the conditions in which you could see a broader financial crisis.
I would say you could throw in there too some a spike in subprime auto loan defaults. They're going up.
Yeah,
but they're not like, from the surface, cause for major concern, but they're definitely going up, John, you know?
Yeah. And you know, in your neck of the woods, Kerry, condo building in South Florida.
Oh, you saw what was happening, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there are an insane number of condos coming on the market, especially in the Miami market.
Yeah. It's an OMG moment, I would say.
there's a year and a half or 2 years of supply in a lot of different parts of South Florida for high-end condos coming on the market. Now, they won't sell quickly enough to allow a lot of these developers to get their money back out. So we'll see some defaults there. And maybe that's the beginning, too. You know, you toss that into the mix. None of these things that we're talking about are big enough in and of themselves to cause the overall system to roll over. But, you know, throw four or five of them out there. So there's always something bad in the headlines, and you'll change the mindset of traders and investors and probably generate a lot of risk-off trading, which would, you know, at current price levels, cause potentially a pretty big, pretty sharp drop in certainly in stock prices, possibly in bond prices, possibly in high-end real estate prices. So you get one or two, those two things going, and then we're so financially fragile that we won't be able to handle it. And by we, I mean the global financial system. And you'll see crises bubbling up everywhere. All of a sudden, we'll start looking for trouble, and we'll find it out there. You know, right now, nobody's paying attention to the Italian banking system, or to France's government finances, or to Japan's government finances, or to China's bursting credit bubble. But once there's a reason to start looking for stuff like that, we will find it everywhere. And then it'll be very easy to become extremely pessimistic, and the tone of the financial markets will change on a dime. But again, who knows when? You know, it could be 2017 very easily. Could be 2020. There's no way to know. But something like that is definitely coming, because we've basically screwed the system up to the point where a happy ending is an absolute impossibility. We are not going to get out of this without extreme pain for somebody. And so now the question becomes, who is going to be hurt by this? Mm-hmm. Will it be the 1% who sees the assets that have made them even richer over the last decade just tank? Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden you have a lot of billionaires becoming only multimillionaires, you know? And so we'll see all these sob stories about these guys who had to sell their copper mines and to make ends meet because their hotel chains stopped generating cash, stuff like that, you know, or will it be factories closing and banks closing and throwing a lot of people out of work. And so, you know, regular people end up being hurt by this.
Yeah.
Or a combination thereof. You know, usually the 1% comes through these crises in pretty good shape with the help of the government, and everybody else gets screwed. And it wouldn't be a surprise if that happened again, just because that's the past pattern. But again, you know, the specifics of the coming crisis are always impossible to predict ahead of time. And the timing is always impossible to predict. Although when you look back on it 5 years later, it's obvious. Oh, yeah, we should have done this then. And look how much money we would have made. So now we're right back in that intellectual challenge where we have to figure out how to time this just right to make the absolute maximum amount of money so that we can look back, our future selves can look back at our current selves and say, wow, they did it just right. They were so smart, you know, and that's what everybody wants who's in financial markets. We want to look brilliant in retrospect. And right now it's not clear how to do that, though.
No, it's not. Well, that's what we have to look forward to. And you know it's coming. It's one of those things. It's like death and taxes. Unfortunately, taxes, you know, are coming April 15th. Death, well, it's kind of like death. You know, it's out there lurking, and you just don't know exactly when it's going to happen. And that's the bad thing, right?
Yes.
Yes. So I guess we have to leave it at that, but it's certainly coming sooner rather than later, and that we know. So check out John's work over at dollarcollapse.com. Check out us at Financial Survival Network. Any questions, comments, or need for information, write us an email, kl@kerrylutz.com, kl@kerrylutz.com. And Twitter feed is @kerrylutz. And the Facebook page is Financial Survival Network. And we will pick up where we left off next Monday. John, we'll talk to you then.
Thanks, Kerry. Talk to you then.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.